A few months ago, David Stoher, who is now a professor at ETH Zurich, came at EPFL to give a talk about a mysterious algorithm called sum of squares. Stoher claims that this could be an optimal algorithm in the sense that it might be able to tackle efficiently all tractable problems. In particular, one of Stoher's slides placed sum of squares at the center of a huge network of extremely hot and difficult fields of research, from complexity theory to functional analysis, including as well high-dimensional data, machine learning, and quantum information. The audience was silenced. I got to talk to a few professors who attended Stoher's talk, and most of them had never heard of sum of squares. I certainly had not. And we were all wondering the same thing. Is this bullshit? Or is sum of squares the next best thing? So when Stoher's main co-author, Professor Boaz Barak of Harvard University, came to EPFL, I had to ask him a few questions. Starting with, is sum of squares the real deal?
This is now a candidate algorithm that seems to be doing well as we know for a class of, you know, combinatorial optimization problems, and trying to understand if this is, you know, whether this is the right algorithm and whether even there should exist even a right algorithm is still very much an open problem.
While a lot has already been discovered by professors Stoher and Barak, it seems that the research on sum of squares is still at a very early phase. So let's dig in a little bit more into this algorithm. What is sum of squares?
Its history comes from a question of Hilbert. Whenever a polynomial is non-negative, can you certify it by writing it as a, you know, a sum of squares of other polynomial? Because obviously, a square is always non-negative, and a sum of squares is a non-negative polynomial.
If this were true, it would mean that any polynomial could be proved to be non-negative by showing that it can be written as a sum of squares of polynomials. Unfortunately, Hilbert
showed that there exists a non-negative polynomial that cannot be written as a sum of squares of other polynomials.
Now, Hilbert's proof was non-constructive, but in the 1960s, Motzkin provided this simple example with only two variables and of degree 6. 1 plus x to the 4th times y squared plus x squared times y to the 4th minus 3x squared y squared, which, as you can see on this figure, is indeed non-negative. However, this polynomial cannot be written as a sum of squares of polynomials.
And then in his famous 1900 address, where he laid down 23 hard problems for, the most important problems for mathematics, Hilbert asked as his 17th problem whether every non-negative polynomial can be written as a sum of squares of rational functions.
A rational function is a ratio of polynomials. So, in other words, given any non-negative polynomial, can we find polynomials p1, p2 until pr, and q1, q2 until qr, such that the non-negative polynomial equals p1 squared divided by q1 squared plus p2 squared divided by q2 squared, and so on until pr squared divided by qr squared.
This set off like a research program, and Artin in 1927 showed that the answer is yes. And later, people have shown, like Krivine and Stengel has showed stronger versions that basically said that for every set of polynomial equations you can find with equalities and inequalities, you can, if they are not satisfiable, you can certify that they are not satisfiable with the so-called sum of squares proof.
In other words, a system of polynomial equations can be proved to have no solutions if it implies that a sum of squares can take negative values.
What happened in the early 2000s, and in some sense even a little before it by some researchers, but around that time, people like Naum Shor and then later Lasser and Parillo discovered that these kind of proofs, these kind of sum of squares proofs, can be found by computer programs, by optimization algorithms. specifically semi-definite programs, and that the parameter that really matters here is the degree. So these previous results said that if a set of equations is unsatisfiable, then there is always a sum of squares certificate for that is not satisfiable. Later researchers discovered is that if the degree is small, then you can actually efficiently find this. And the sum of squares algorithm is basically an algorithm that searches for these certificates.
So the heart of sum of squares is an algorithm that inputs any polynomial and that successfully proves either that this polynomial can take negative values or that this polynomial is always non-negative by writing it as a sum of squares of rational functions. And crucially, the computation time of this algorithm is of the order n to the power d, where n is the number of variables of p, and d is the largest degree of rationals whose square add up to p. The remarkable fact of sum of squares is that this computational complexity is polynomial in the number of variables, and is thus still tractable even when we have huge polynomials, as long as these polynomials don't have a high degree.
You can view it as kind of a common generalization of several lines of algorithmic research. One is spectral methods that are based on eigenvalues and eigenvectors, and the other is linear programming. And in some sense, if you marry them together and you kind of generalize beyond it, you get sum of squares.
Of course, there's still a lot more to be said about the inner working of sum of squares, as well as about how many computational problems can be reduced to sum of squares. But now that we have a rough idea of what sum of squares does, let's try to answer the question of this video. Could sum of squares be an optimal algorithm?
So I think it's in some sense not exactly a yes or no question, because the question in some sense, like every algorithm, almost, the silliest possible algorithm is always maybe optimal for like one problem. So in some sense, the real question is how wide is the set of problems that for which sum of squares would be optimal? And is it like trivially small, or is it like interestingly, we know it's not everything, and I think we also know it's not nothing. But how wide is it? And I think, for example, for constraint satisfaction problems, which is a very important class of problems. So you have like some number of constraints, say these kind of soft constraints, which you can violate or you can satisfy, and say it gives you one if it's satisfied and zero if it's violated. And you want to maximize the number of constraints you satisfy. So for these kind of problems, we seem to have fairly good intuition that sum of squares is optimal, at least if you allow a little bit of an error, you want to maximize it up to some, small additive error. This is my current, guess that it is optimal for this class of problems, which is a very interesting problem. It contains a lot of problems we want to solve in real life. But we still have work to do to prove it.
Now, this is a nice conjecture, but it doesn't really feel like it would be a good answer to the question we raised. What would be the theorem that should be proved to answer, yes, in a fairly intuitive sense, sum of squares is an optimal algorithm?
We are still not at the point where we, I think, know how to state the right theorem. Like, I conjecture that there is a conjecture. So I think we're still not understanding things enough that we understand what is the right conjecture, the most general and powerful phrasing of this conjecture. So I think we're kind of like still seeing some, some part of the picture here, and we're not yet, we don't yet know what's really the right conjecture to state. So, for example, the unique games conjecture is a super interesting conjecture, but it seems to only touch on part of this picture, and I think it should be like a special case of a more general thing that we are still not understanding.
I guess that there is still a lot that we don't understand. And I find it very exciting. It means that there are a lot of new discoveries to be made in this line of research with potential huge implications in very diverse areas. In particular, Professors Barak and Storer have produced a lot of materials freely available online for those of you who want to learn more about this modern approach to algorithm design and want to contribute to this extremely mysterious and intriguing line of work.
My problem with the work of Gomez and Williamson exactly is that it was brilliant. So the problem is that this step uses the C word, which is a dirty word in this talk.
I want to understand what changes about a problem that makes it suddenly jump from being easy to being hard.